whatever follows it will be like the blinking of an eye. Everything that comes after will be like a blinking of an eye, as if you only just slept recently. So basically, if you, there's been goodness for you given inside the grave, then you know that you'll, whatever will come after that will be khair and goodness for you. Wallahu a'lam.
If you know you are going to die, for example, you have cancer and you have a few months to live, will your repentance be accepted during this time, or is it too late?
Yani, obviously nobody knows when they're going to die. Many people have suffered from cancer and then they've been saved from the cancer. Wallahu a'lam. And likewise, as long as your soul is not come to your throat, then tawbah is open for you, and this could be a form of blessing for that individual that you've got been given ample time to repent back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you're lifted in this manner.
What are the five benefits of shahada, being
shaheed?
Please speak
loud. Any of the other aspects, far my memory serves me correct, any that the person, any before the blood touches the ground, that all their sins will be forgiven, there'll be no punishment of the grave, there'll be a crown that we placed upon their head. Likewise, that we find they'll be married to 70 women, or that two women of paradise will be given to them. These are some of the benefits that come to my mind at this stage. Wallahu a'lam, maybe the brother can elaborate as well, inshallah.
What is the state of a person who did good and bad in the dunya? Will they be able to answer the questions in the grave, or is it only the two extremes? What is their purification?
Allahu ahkamul hakimin. Yeah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that will judge. Simple. No man can judge another individual, as we've become at the moment to label and to judge people. It only belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A person could be a sinner, have some good actions. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes something of their good actions. We find many a hadith, the woman who's a baghiyah, a prostitute woman who's been forgiven. Likewise, the man who gave water to the dog, etc. All of this has been highlighted. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that will judge individuals. Nobody knows what is inside a man's heart or a woman's heart, and he can forgive whoever he wants to forgive, and no one can step into that and question that forgiveness. But that is iman in the Ahl Sunnah. To have khawf, to have fear that the individual may be punished. To have fear you may be punished, and hope that you'll be forgiven, and have love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the correct belief of iman. Not just to go upon love. That is the way of these people, the deviant people like the Christians, etc., who believe everything. Zindiq, who believe that everything is based upon love, and the Christians as well. As long as you love Isa, that is sufficient, you go to paradise. And then the Ahlu Tasawwuf, who believe to fear Allah, everything you do should be a state of fear. That is the way they understand what iman is. But the real understanding of iman is to have love and hope and fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Love Him for the things that He has given us, to have hope in Him that He will forgive us, and have fear that He may punish at the same time. And likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated that He, verily His mercy has overtaken His wrath. That His mercy has overtaken His wrath. So a person should be looking forward to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And likewise, we find in the hadith that I am in the thought, you know, I am as a servant thinks about me. So if everybody has that belief that I will be forgiven, and holds that inside their heart and thinks about that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, inshallah, forgive that individual. As for to go into fine detail, who will be forgiven, who will not be forgiven, if you have a mixture of good deeds and bad deeds, then you should hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you and wipe out those bad deeds. And likewise, you find that the good deeds, increase in good deeds, for really they wipe out the bad deeds. That is the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even if you think of a good hasana, a good deed, it is written down as if you've done that good deed. If you carry out that good deed, it's folded, manifold many times. And you think of an evil deed and you don't do it, you get one hasana, one good deed. And you do the sin, and you carry out the sin, only one sayyi'ah is written down upon you. This is the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So even though you may think that you are in a balance, you've got as many bad deeds as good deeds, maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, you've got many good deeds. More good deeds than the bad deeds.
How would a woman, a sister, reach the level of martyrdom such as that of a man, a soldier?
Naam, her jihad, yani, is in the performance of hajj. And a woman, that's her form of jihad. To give childbirth, if she dies in a state of childbirth, she is a shahida, she is a martyr, inshallah. Likewise, if a building falls upon an individual, is a form of shaheed. If a person dies from a stomach disease, is a type of shaheed. Likewise, if a person who drowns, etc. But the ultimate form for a man is to die in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why it's always referred to as qital, fighting, not jihad. Some people try to understand it, because jihad can be translated as struggle. But the real meaning is qital, to fight. As for a woman, her jihad is to perform the hajj, and she's lived in that state. That is the way that she is a shaheed, inshallah.
Will there be a paradise for all Muslims after being punished for their sins?
Every Muslim who says the Shahada will go to paradise. And the key to paradise is La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. But as Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab mentioned, that every single key has teeth. Every single key has teeth to open the doors to paradise. So don't just rely just upon the Shahada. Like what you find in the hadith as well, that when the Prophet Muhammad said that everybody who comes into this garden, whoever comes, give them the gladdings of paradise. And then when Umar heard this statement, he pushed Abu Hurairah and he fell down on his back. He said, how can you just go and say this to an individual? Whoever says La ilallah, dakhal al-jannah. Whoever says these words will go into paradise. So he went to the Prophet Muhammad, and Abu Hurairah had tears in his eyes. Had tears in his eyes that this is what Umar done to me. Did you say these words? That whoever says La ilallah, dakhal al-jannah will enter into paradise? He said, yes, I did. He said, don't let the people rely just upon this. Don't just go and spread this, because it will become very easy for people to accept this, which has come common in society. You say La ilaha illallah, you're going to go to paradise. It is true, but you need to come with actions as well. When you stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at least you try to do something. The one who comes with some actions and the correct belief and stands in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can show, at least I try to do something in this dunya. That's why a person who try utmost in this dunya to excel inside actions, what they can do, and not rely upon this. Because this is a concept of the Christians, that iman is just to call upon the name of Isa. Likewise, the Muslims that we find, call upon the name Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you go into paradise, shafa'a will become open for you. This is only the belief of Nasara, the belief of the Christians, which has spread and come into the belief of the Muslims. Just say his name and you'll enter into paradise is an incorrect belief, and a person should be far away from that, but rather making ittiba', making imitation or following of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Anyone besides the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam can do intercession on the day of
judgment? There's various ranks of the people who have the right to do intercession, all of them by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The martyrs will have a right, and likewise we find the Anbiya will have a right as well, and it will carry on going down in various stages until finally Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will himself choose certain people and put them into paradise as well.
What are the 6 points or ways in which to avoid the punishment of the grave?
Anyway, Allah, I don't know if there's such thing as 6 points. There may be more than those points to avoid the punishment of the grave. Allah knows best.
If a person dies in Hajj, for instance, as soon as they've done the Hajj rituals, does that mean that all their sins were forgiven?
Anyway, the person who performs Hajj and dies in that state, then obviously they are like the day their mother gave birth to them. They have a clean slate, they are free from their sins. So as soon as they perform the Hajj, and if they are lifted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then they are free. If their intention was correct, all their sins will be wiped away and they will be lifted up in this pure state by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Basically, as I understand this question, the brother, sister's asking about, fight those people who don't believe in Allah and the last day, came after the struggle 13 years after the da'wah and hardship, how can we implement this today? At the end of the day, we have to understand that jihad is in various forms. And some of them have written at the moment that current state of warfare is a state of defense of just the Muslim lands. Because at the moment, these people are attacking the noble lands and taking the property which belongs to the Muslims. And somebody needs to stand there and defend that. This forever stagnation of people, of their fiqh and their understanding, to think that we have to... For example, if somebody entered this building at the moment, I'm sure this building was bombarded by Christians at the moment. Those who would run will be classified as the munafiqeen. Those who stood there and defended the masjid would begin to defend the masjid. No one would turn around and say, let us travel to the ulama and ask them what we should do now. You're being attacked now. Yeah, your intellect will tell you, simple, your family is being attacked, the people in this community is being attacked, you have to revolt against them or defend them. That is all that we are saying. We are not saying go out to these people and harm these individuals. That which belongs to the Muslims, belongs to the Muslims. The land of Iraq, the land of Kashmir, the land of Palestine, the land of Shishan, all these lands belong to the Muslims. There's no debate about this. Even according to their sanctions, according to the United Nations, the land belongs to those people. And that's all these people are trying to do, claim back their land. They're not committing any atrocities, the land belongs to them. And finally, the land belongs, the whole of the land, earth belongs to Allah. إِنَّ الْأَرْضَ لِلَّهِ يُورِثُهَا مَنْ يَشَاءُ مِنْ عِبَادِي وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. The whole of the land only belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He gives it to whoever he wants from amongst his slaves. So that's all that these people are trying to do. You say, leave our noble lands, stay away from our country, and don't oppress any of our people. As for the other forms of jihad, then when the time comes, then we can engage in that if we have